What are you looking at on your phone?
I was reading or watching a video.
What video were you watching?
It was about Mark Driscoll, of all people.
Mark Driscoll, the trumpet player?
No.
No, that's Phil Driscoll. Phil Driscoll, Mark Driscoll.
I thought Phil Driscoll was the guy who does the worship, like dances around and...
No, Phil, I'm pretty
that's
sure...
Phil, that's Phil Wickham.
Phil Wickham.
Yeah.
Yeah. And a different era of time. Like, this is... Phil Wickham would be now... Phil Driscoll is a trumpet player from the 80s.
Mm. Okay, yeah.
So, yeah. Mark Driscoll.
Mark Driscoll.
Who is a preacher,
mm-hmm.
right?
Yep.
And he was in Washington State.
Mm-hmm.
And something happened in the church, and then mm-hmm. he's back into ministry now.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yep.
He has a very rough background.
Yeah, he got kicked off a stage. There's a video I was watching. He got kicked off stage.
Recently?
Mm-hmm. At a men's conference.
Okay.
So that I'm trying to figure out why he got kicked off stage. It's clickbait.
Yes, that's exactly what it is.
What is this?
Yeah, well, there you go. Phil, Phil Driscoll, Mark Driscoll, Phil Wickham.
Phil Wickham.
All in one little... Yeah, and that was pretty serious right there. We went serious right up front.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
We did.
Yeah.
And jokey.
And jokey, yeah. All right, well, let's see what we can do.
A great light dawns in Galilee. Some say madman, some say king. Wonder-working rebel priest. Jesus Christ the Nazarene. He knew well what it would take to free us all from sin and grave. A perfect man would have to die, and only he could pay that price.
Welcome to Wednesday Night's Bible Study. My name is Philip Brand, and this is Seth Parnell.
Hello.
And Seth is here to give just a knee-jerk reaction to what I'm going to be teaching this evening. And so he hasn't studied any of this before now. So he has no idea what we're going to say today. Nope. Though he may be familiar with the passages.
Maybe.
I mean, that's fair, right?
I've read the Bible.
Yeah, so you've read the Bible, right. So Mark, just a little review. Mark is really making a case for different things that are happening in the church. Hmm. And once you start realize that, you can see some connections to what he's doing as he tells the story of Jesus and supports the truth and the truth that should be infused into the church. The last time we were with you, we talked about the Mountain of Transfiguration. And you were not with us. Grayson was.
Yep.
And so the title of this Bible study is More Misunderstandings.
Mm.
More Misunderstandings. And the last Bible study was a misunderstanding of what was happening at the Transfiguration. Like, what is happening? We have Elijah and Moses and Jesus. Let's make three tents. And to kind of dive into why that happened, you'll need to listen to the other Bible study. But those three disciples misunderstood what was happening. Mm. They misunderstood what Jesus was telling them. And now Mark gives us several more examples of misunderstandings when it comes to what Jesus is saying and what Jesus is doing. And a misunderstanding about what Jesus has empowered you to do and what that actually means. So it's just a lot of misunderstandings. So this Bible study is a lot of misunderstandings.
I hope I understand it.
Yeah. Yeah. Hopefully we can make it clear and people don't misunderstand what we're saying today.
Yeah.
Especially that first part. When we first came in, don't misunderstand that, okay? Regardless of how you feel about that past, don't put it on me. Okay. So, chapter 9, verse 14 says this, and when they came to the disciples, they saw a great crowd around them and scribes arguing with them. So they're coming down off the mountain, all four of them, and there's an argument going on. And just to kind of give you a spoiler alert, it's an argument about something that the disciples have been unable to do. Okay, so this is the first time in Mark where Mark emphasizes something that Jesus has empowered the disciples to do that they are now not able to do. Okay, so they're not able to do something, and it's something that they were previously empowered to do. Okay, so verse 15, and immediately all the crowd, when they saw him, were greatly amazed and ran up to him and greeted him. This is also a first for Mark. Because usually what you have is a story about Jesus. He teaches, people are amazed. He heals people, people are amazed. And they're just in awe of him. Well, here, at the very beginning of the story, people are amazed. He hasn't even done anything yet, but they're amazed by him. So they're greatly amazed, and they ran up to him and greeted him. So they run to him. So verse 16 through 18, and he asked them, what are you arguing about with them? And someone from the crowd answered him, teacher, I brought my son to you, for he has a spirit that makes him mute. Means he has a demon. And whenever it seizes him, it throws him down, and he foams and grinds and his teeth and becomes rigid. Now, at this point, you think, what, epilepsy?
Yeah.
Right? That's what you think. So you say, well, why did you say it was demon possession, Philip? Well, you'll see in a minute. So I asked your disciples to cast it out. So this guy thinks it's a demon. And they were not able. And he answered them, O faithless generation, how long am I to be with you? How long am I to bear with you? Bring him to me. So we know that from chapter 6, verse 13, Jesus has given all the apostles the power to exorcise demons. He sends them out two by two to do that. They can exorcise demons, they can heal people, and they can teach about the kingdom of God. We know that that power has been given to them, right? But what this shows us is that just because God has empowered you to do something, or Jesus has empowered you to do something, doesn't mean it becomes your personal power at that point. So, like at Christmas, you get a gift. What was the best gift you got this Christmas? Be careful, because Heather might be listening.
I know. She got me a decal for my Jeep.
Oh, a decal. Is it an American flag one?
Yeah, the one on the mirror, on the window.
On the window, American flag decal. Mm-hmm. Well, you know, it's yours.
Yeah.
You put it on your Jeep. Now I know you're married, and what's hers is yours, and what yours is hers. I know that. But
This is mine.
This is yours. So this is yours. So it is something that you have. You drive around with it. Mm-hmm. You're always going to have it. Mm-hmm. We often think of gifts that God gives us in the same manner. I have the gift of teaching, so I'm always going to have it. I have the gift of mercy, so I'm always going to have it. I have the gift of discernment, so I'm always going to have it. We become very possessive. It's ours.
I own it.
Yeah. But the difference between that American flag gift and the gifts that Jesus gives you for ministry is they are not always available when you want them. They're just not always available. It is still his power being lent to you. And so he may have given you the gift, but that doesn't mean you're going to be able to do it. So this is what's happening here. They were able to exorcise other demons, but they couldn't exorcise this demon at this moment because currently Jesus hasn't given them that power. Okay? Hasn't given them that power. Another side of this is people may not know, but the Jewish religious leaders had a system for exorcising demons. Did you know that?
I didn't.
Yeah. So they would quote like Deuteronomy chapter 6 over a person that had a demon. They would quote Psalm chapter 3 over a person that had a demon. They would quote Psalm chapter 91 over a person that had a demon in order to exorcise that demon out of them. So it was more like a magic book, like magic words.
Right.
Excuse me. The difference between the disciples and Jesus is they just spoke the word and he left. There was no recanting of scripture or any type of words. So it seems here that the disciples do not have the faith to cast this demon out. And so they're having a crisis of faith, and the Father is having a crisis of faith as well. And where we get that is, and they brought the boy to him, and when the spirit saw him, immediately it convulsed the boy, and he fell to the ground and rolled about foaming at the mouth. And Jesus asked his father, how long has it been happening to him? And he said, from childhood. It has often cast him into fire. So that's on purpose. That's how you know it's a demon and not epilepsy. Yeah. Or into water. See. Or just to destroy him. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. So that if you can do anything is, I'm not sure that you can do something. I'm just not sure. Your disciples have not been able to do this. Jesus recognizes that because he makes his disciples, his apostles, a part of the faithless generation. Mm-hmm. So they're having a struggle of faith, and so is this father. And the father's having a struggle of faith because Jesus is representative. So let's stop there a minute. How many times do people struggle believing Jesus because of what we have done? Mm. Because of our lack of faith.
Yeah.
Because we are not living it, because we are not really faithful, because we can't get something done. Yeah. That we should be able to get done. I think it's very important for us to live our best selves at all times. And our best selves meaning be like Christ in everything that we do. Because it matters. People's faith is dependent upon our witness and how we live. And if you're not living for Jesus, people are going to doubt Jesus. If you're living for Jesus, if they doubt Jesus, at least it's not because of you.
Yeah,
at least they know that you believe and you are following the stuff that you proclaim that you're following.
Yeah.
So what do you think about that little point?
It's convicting.
It's very convicting, isn't it?
I mean, I don't know if I've ever really... I've heard this saying before. I've read Mark, yeah. Oh, faithless generation. But I've never really thought about it. Like, they did not have faith. Mm-hmm. And that was key. In this moment, it was keeping them from seeing this miracle happen.
Mm-hmm.
And I know the times where I've maybe doubted God, not thinking about those around me that are looking at me,
yeah,
and that see that doubt, and I don't know what happened, but maybe they went, well, if he doubts, then I'm going to doubt too.
Yeah.
And yeah, that's a good point.
Yeah.
Huh.
So it's a lot to chew on there.
Yeah.
Yeah, so verse 21, and Jesus asked his father, how long has this been? Oh, we already said that. Verse 23, and Jesus said to him, if you can. So Jesus is like, what do you mean, if I can? Right? And it is an irritation here. Like, what do you mean, if I can? All things are possible for one who believes. So that is a communication to the apostles and the disciples that can't do it. Hmm. And it's a communication to the Father about his faith. And the father picks up on this because the next thing that he says is this. Immediately the father of the child cried out and said, I believe, help my unbelief. Hmm. Lord, you're right. Help me where I do not believe. I want my son to be healed. I want this demon away from him. Just help my unbelief. Just help me, help me, help me, help me, help me. And when Jesus saw that a crowd came running together, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to it, you mute and deaf spirit, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. This is also one of the first passages of scripture where there's a demon possession in Mark where the demon doesn't talk to Jesus before he does it. Hmm. So the dumb and deaf, I don't know what type of demon this is, but he definitely can't speak Hebrew or Greek.
Yeah.
Or Aramaic for that matter. So he's dumb. He's mute and deaf. Verse 26, and after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out and the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said, he is dead. I think it's interesting that as we have gone through Mark, that the resistance of the spiritual world in regards to demons and Satan becomes stronger and stronger and stronger and stronger. And it's more prevalent as the story continues. Mm. We constantly see this war, this spiritual war on the outside of everything that's naturally happening. And so Mark is emphasizing that. And I think this is a discussion that possibly the church was happening, having in their day. The church was having in their day. Okay? A discussion about spiritual warfare. And then Paul writes about it. So you can see how this kind of fits in, right? There's always something spiritual, a spiritual warfare going on that we can't see. And so Mark, as you read along, this gets stronger and stronger and stronger till finally that power is broken at the cross. And I think that's one of Mark's points. The power grew, but its stopping point was at the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ. Mm. It broke its power. The cure for the Son revolves around the faith of the Father.
Yeah.
In other places, it's the faith of the one that wants to be healed, but it's the faith of the Father. And we've seen this before. So it's your faith that determines whether or not God is going to, you know, heal the person or not. It is the thing. It doesn't mean that if you had faith that he could heal your loved one and didn't, that you didn't have enough faith. That's not what I'm saying. I'm just saying here, it seems to revolve around this father's belief system and what this father believed. Mm. And so the text continues, and in verse 26, and after crying out and convulsing him terribly, it came out and the boy was like a corpse, so that most of them said he's dead, but he's not dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him up, and he arose. And when he entered the house, that means he's going to have a private time with his disciples and apostles, his disciples asked him privately, "Why could we not cast it out? We had the gift before, but in this case, it didn't happen. Why could we not cast it out?" That question tells you everything that you need to know.
Hmm. Why couldn't we do it?
Why couldn't we do it? Hmm. Well, you couldn't do it before Jesus gave you the power. Hmm. So they must have thought that they possessed that power from that point on and could do it anytime they wanted to, at will, when they decided to do it. Hmm. So Jesus says, "This kind cannot be driven out by anything but prayer." And in that statement, Jesus is reminding his disciples where the power of the gift comes from. Hmm. And you and I have spiritual gifts, but the power for that those spiritual gifts isn't ours to control at will. It is ours to depend on the God that gave them to us. Hmm. So we depend on God for the power to use our gifts. The moment that we think that the gifts are ours and it's us wielding that power is the moment that we lose our humility.
Yeah.
And we become very prideful and the power is cut off from us. Mm. That's a huge lesson.
Yeah.
You know, I've told you this before. I have the gift of discernment, but there's times I can't discern. Mm-hmm. Sometimes it's because God just doesn't want me to discern that particular situation for whatever reason. Other times it's because I didn't pray for it. Hmm. Lord, please, I'm leaning on you. You've given me this gift, but I need that power. I need your power. This gift isn't mine, but it's a tool that you've given me to use. Please help me use it. Give me the power to use it. Hmm. So when you teach, like you're teaching this Wednesday night, it's the same thing. Lord, give me the power to exercise the gift that you have given me.
Yeah.
Anytime we don't ask for that power, ask for him to work with us, is the moment that we're relying on our own power rather than his. Mm-hmm. So even though I know that this gift seems bigger, I mean, more powerful, like we can cast out demons, woo, you know, it's still the same as our spiritual gifts.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we are constantly dependent on the power of God to exercise those gifts. Mm. So what do you think about all that?
Yeah. I mean, I can see that it's true in my own life. The times, just the example of teaching. There's some people who are just very skilled orators.
Yeah, they are.
And they can talk, and I'm not one of them. And so I know that times where I teach or preach and I've not given that time over to God and just said, Lord, this is yours, and it flops.
Yeah, yeah.
But other times where the Holy Spirit uses it, and even when I don't think I did a good job teaching, like the Holy Spirit was still using something because it's His gift. Mm-hmm. And so, yeah, and other areas too, I've seen it in my life where I've thought it was my own gift, and I tried to use it and go in my own strength and going, why can't I do this?
Yeah, yeah.
It's because I'm not relying, I'm not being humble in that moment. So yeah, that's interesting.
Yeah. So to wrap up this particular section, you have three disciples that didn't understand the transfiguration because they were focused on themselves. And then you have nine that didn't understand why they couldn't exorcise a demon. So they misunderstood their role in the whole thing. And so misunderstandings can actually prevent you from, first of all, understanding the truth of the scriptures. Of course, because it's a misunderstanding. Mm-hmm. But two, it could hinder you from actually doing the ministry that God's called you to do. Mm. Yep.
Yeah.
Two very important lessons, I think, from that.
Yeah.
All right, well, let's continue. Verse 33. And he came to Capernaum, and when he was in the house... Oh, wait, is that right? Yeah. And they came to Capernaum, and when he... That's not right. Verse 30. My fault. Verse 30,
because of that.
I was looking for Galilee, and there's Capernaum. I was like, this is too early in the Bible study.
I was right there with you.
Yeah, I'm glad. I'm sure everybody else was too, because I think I said verse 33.
Yeah.
All right, verse 30. They went on from there and passed through Galilee, and he did not want anyone to know, for he was teaching his disciples, saying. So he's going through Galilee. He didn't want anyone to know that they're there. He wanted some private time with his disciples. Part of the reason he didn't want anybody to know is, of course, that private time. But second, this is Jesus going to Jerusalem. And when he arrives in Jerusalem, he knows at the end of that trip, he's going to die. He's going to be put on a cross. So this is his final trip to Jerusalem on this side of the empty tomb.
Right.
Okay. And so he didn't want anybody to know. And then he gives the second prediction of his death and resurrection. It says this: the Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men, and they will kill him. And when he is killed, after 3 days, he will arise. Now, for the Jews that are reading Mark, they know that in Scripture, especially in Daniel chapter 7, it says that all authority is going to be given to the Messiah, and he is going to rule the world. But here, Jesus is saying, Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. He's going to be delivered into their power to do with him as they wish. So, of course, that's a prediction of his death. That's a prediction of what the Pharisees did. That's a prediction of what Pilate did, that he's delivered. That particular word delivered is actually another word that we translate betrayed as well. Delivered over to, like given to, so deliver over to. So this is a hint that there's an inside job going on in this prophecy. So when you start thinking in terms of inside jobs and Jesus being delivered over to the authorities, who's the first person you think of?
I think of Judas.
Absolutely. So you're sitting here, okay, this must be Judas. So Judas is going to, it's an inside job, it's getting ready, he's going to be betrayed by one of the 12. That's what that absolutely represents. However, there is another person that is on the inside that is going to deliver Jesus. Do you know who that is?
Peter?
Yeah, of course. So we start going down through the list of like actual people.
Is it I, Lord? Is it
Because when you're looking at the Greek, you know that this might not be Judas. This might be somebody else, and it is somebody else. The Son of Man is going to be delivered into the hands of men. And once you start studying that, you realize that the other inside person is God the Father. God the Father is going to willingly let his Son, actually, it's more than willing. he's going to have his son delivered into the hands of man. Because nothing like that happens without God the Father being involved.
Right.
For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever believeth in him would not perish but have everlasting life. Well, how did God give actively his son? He delivered his son over to the authorities on earth.
Wow.
That's powerful.
Yeah.
So, you know, of course, we're fine with God the Father delivering. We don't like Judas, but we're fine with that because we realize that that is promoted out of love for us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's a powerful verse, especially when it comes to salvation. How did that strike you?
Yeah, I mean, I see that immediately after you say it. Yeah, who else could deliver Jesus?
Yeah.
But God.
Right. I mean,
who else has that power to do that but God?
And then when he is killed, after 3 days, he will arise, actually goes back to that person that delivered him into the hands for death, is actually the same person that's going to raise him from the dead.
Mm.
That's pretty cool.
Yeah.
Yeah. Not going to leave him there.
Huh.
Verse 32, but they did not understand the saying and were afraid to ask him. I don't know why they were afraid to ask him. Maybe because they didn't want to seem dumb. And I'm not so sure that that isn't the number one reason. We don't want to ask because we don't want to seem like we don't know what he's saying. We don't want to be dumb because we have another objective.
Hmm.
We have another objective.
Hmm.
And the objective is seen in verse 33. And they came to Capernaum. And when he was in the house, he asked them, "Hey, what were you discussing on the way? Have you ever done that to your kids?" No, they're not old enough yet. So when they get in elementary school, you will know if they've been discussing something that you might not approve of. Like, so what were y'all talking about?
Yeah.
You know, what were you talking about back there in the back seat or in the playhouse or whatever? You might overhear a little bit of the conversation and it not be so positive. Mm. And you ask them that question. Well, that's the same type of question Jesus is asking here. So what were you guys talking about? And your kids are going to do the same thing that the disciples did, okay? But they kept silent. It's like that awkward moment, like,
Yep.
And it's not, I don't know what he's talking about. It's, I know what he's talking about. Did he overhear that somehow? Why is this question being asked? My kids did it. Your kids are going to do it too.
Yep.
Disciples do it. So for on the way, they had argued with one another about who was the greatest. Who's the greatest? That's what they were talking about. The reason that they were afraid to ask him was because they wanted to be the greatest. And if he asked him a question because he didn't understand, that would hinder your ability to be the greatest, because the greatest one was the one that always understood Jesus. You see how that works?
Yep.
Crazy. All right, verse 35, and he sat down and called the 12, and he said to them, "If anyone would be first, he must be last of all, a servant of all." He must be last, he must be the servant of all. That means that greatest isn't a position that you jockey for. Greatness is a position that you serve and you become.
Hmm.
It's not something you seek. It's something that happens because of your care for other people.
Hmm.
So you're arguing about who will be the greatest, and the greatest person is the one that serves and is not even worried about being the greatest.
It's not something to achieve.
Right.
You try to achieve it, it just happens.
Yeah, I think this speaks to people in churches that want to gain power in a church.
Hmm.
Like they come in as members or even pastors or even deacons or even elders that just come in and they want to control everything.
Hmm.
That's not how the church works. We're all servants.
Hmm.
You know, a lot of people love to point to the pastor or the pastoral staff like you and say, well, they should be servants of us, as if humbled and do what we say. Well, that's also a wrong attitude.
Hmm.
Church people are servants just like church staff are servants. We're all servants.
Right.
And if we're jockeying to be the greatest, that's really a sin. It's a sin of pride. That's not what we're here for. We, and I have to be careful saying this, but we, I guess I'm speaking for you, see this sometimes with church leaders at church conferences.
Hmm.
where people are jockeying, and you can just feel like that person thinks that they're important. And mm-hmm. do you know what I mean?
Yep.
And once a person starts thinking they're important and they're climbing the ladder and they're jockeying to be the greatest, mm-hmm. That's the moment that they're not the greatest.
Right. Yeah. I'm the most humblest.
Yeah, I'm the most humblest. Yeah. Or, you know, look at what I've done. People right. should respect me. I should have that position. Mm-hmm. And it's a jockeying for power. The goal of any servant of God is not to jockey for power. It's to figure out how to serve other people. Mm-hmm. And you serve other people with your gifts.
Yeah.
Your gifts, by the way, that are empowered by God and not you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hmm. So, to give an illustration, because Jesus loves illustrations, and he took a child and put him in the midst of them, and taking him in his arms, he said to them, "Whoever receives one such child in my name," you can underline that "in my name," "receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me." Now, just like back then is kind of similar to today, it is not seen as a sign of strength for a man to spend time with children. Mm-hmm. And I need to kind of qualify that, to give children a level of importance. It's just not something that men do. Mm. Wouldn't you agree? I mean that.
Yeah.
Yeah. So when what Jesus is saying is, if you will serve children, that means you have the right heart attitude for a servant of mine, and therefore will be the greatest in the kingdom. Mm. So when you take the time for the people that are devalued the most. Mm-hmm. But this isn't Jesus taking the side of people that are devalued. This is Jesus saying, your pride is preventing you from serving the least. You need to humble yourself like a child in order to be a great servant. Hmm. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You humble yourself. So whoever receives one such child in my name receives me, and whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me. So you receive the least, you concentrate on the least, you make the children important, and that shows that you have a good heart. Hmm. So what do you have to say about that little section before we do our last one?
I think it's interesting because it makes me think of our church motto, children, community, culture.
Yeah.
I mean, I think that's something that our church strives to do, is to think about the children, and we get that from Jesus.
Yeah, we do.
Because they're important.
Mm-hmm.
It's not on the shirt there, but I think it's on the back.
Yeah,
but the whole time right. you're saying that, I'm like, yeah, children, community, culture.
Mm-hmm. You start with those, and then you, if you have a heart to serve children, you're going to have a heart for ministry everywhere else.
Yeah.
And that's a biblical truth.
Yeah.
It's a biblical truth. Mm. And a heart for children means you're going to spend time with them.
Mm-hmm.
Like, it's not, oh, I've got a heart for Jesus, but you never talk to one.
Right.
Yeah. Right. All right, last section. Misunderstandings. Okay, we misunderstood how to be great, misunderstood the prophecy, misunderstood why we couldn't do the gift that was given to us. A lot of misunderstandings. We might even title the Bible study "A Lot of Misunderstanding." I know I said that before, by the way. Okay, so verse 38, John said to him, "Teacher, we saw someone casting out demons in your name." Somebody else is doing ministry besides us. And we tried to stop him.
Oh, yeah.
So it's a guy. We tried to stop him. Hmm. Because he was not following us. He's not going where we're going. He's not listening to you. He's not coming to the little powwow sessions that we have. He is doing this on his own. We are not cool with this. And we want you to know so that you can stop it. But Jesus said, "Do not stop him, for no one who does a mighty work in my name." Did you get that? In my name. Hmm. So this guy, whoever he is, has the humble heart that would serve children, is the point back. Do you see that point back?
Yeah.
Yeah. And he's also pointing out that you are not humble by thinking that you're the only game in town. Hmm. Right? So we'll be soon able soon afterward to speak evil of me. For the one who is not against us is for us. For truly I say to you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will by no means lose his reward. Okay? So this is a similarity. I don't know if Mark is really throwing back to this passage of scripture, but he could be to something that happened in the Old Testament.
Okay.
In Numbers. And it's Numbers. Of course, I need to flip this over to get my bearings right. Numbers chapter 11, verses 27 through 29. It says this. Well, let's start with 26. Now, two men remained in the camp, one named Eldad and the other Medad, and the Spirit rested on them, and they were among those registered, but they had not gone out to the tent, and so they prophesied in the camp. So they're not a part of the main group that are prophesying. So what's happening is Moses is picking leaders, and those leaders are at a meeting, and those leaders are prophesying in the Spirit. These are two men outside of that in group. So it's kind of like Jesus is 12, and then we have a man over here. So verse 27, and a young man ran and told Moses, Eldad and Medad are prophesying in the camp. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the assistant of Moses, from his youth said, my Lord Moses, stop them. You see the similarity?
Hmm.
Like they're doing it over here. They're not part of our group. We need to stop them right now. We should be the only game in town. Okay, but Moses said to him, are you jealous for my sake? Would that all the Lord's people were prophets, that the Lord would put his Spirit on them. And Moses and the elders of Israel returned to the camp.
Hmm.
So if someone is doing ministry that is outside of the Baptist circle, and they're reaching people for Jesus, let's not stop them.
Mm-hmm.
We're good with that.
Yeah.
We're good with that. We they do not have to. We are not the only game in town.
Hmm.
Now, one of the reasons that this is important is because Mark is trying to point out that the Jewish people are not the only game in town.
Hmm.
So the Jewish people are God's chosen people. There's no argument there at all, right? And the Jewish people is where the Messiah is going to come from. There's no argument there at all. The argument, however, that is happening in the church as Mark writes this is, do we reach Gentiles? And these Gentiles are starting churches that are following Jehovah God. We need to put a stop to them. They need to start doing the things of the law. Do you see how this works out? They need to be doing the things of the law and abiding by the law that God gave us. They need to join the Jewish race so that they can be chosen and not be doing stuff over here on their own.
Hmm.
And so what Mark is saying is Jesus says, leave them alone. We are not the only game in town.
Hmm.
Is that, are you?
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's a very strong thing. So basically Mark is saying Gentiles can follow Jesus just like Jews can. This guy over here, he can exorcise people. Like he can exorcise demons and have that power. We don't have to be the only game in town because whoever is for us isn't against us. They're on our team. So Gentile churches are on the same team as Jewish churches.
Yeah, wow.
So what do you...
That was big.
That was huge.
That was big to say back in that day.
Yeah.
Because you have to be a Jew to follow Yahweh is what they all thought.
Right.
So that's
So the text doesn't say it here, but I have a suspicion, not a fact, but a suspicion, two different things, that this guy that was doing these miracles was a Gentile.
I was going to ask if we know.
We don't know for sure. I've looked into it. But the whole stop him because he's not following us has a tribal sort of flavor to it. He's not a part of our tribe, and your tribe will be Jewish. He's outside of that tribe. Let's stop him. And Jesus says, No, for one who is not against us is for us. He's for us.
Yeah. Which, another evidence that Mark is trying to make this whole Gentile thing, like, hey, it's coming.
Right.
We reach out or to
everyone.
Or it's
here.
It's here, yeah. That's part of the kingdom.
And Jesus is trying to tell you that it's coming.
Mm-hmm.
And so the misunderstanding, you know how we have misunderstandings all the way through mm-hmm. here? Mark is trying to tell them that we misunderstood some things why Jesus is here. Yeah. Let's not misunderstand this.
Yeah.
Because currently we're having a misunderstanding about something that Jesus was trying to tell us back when he was here.
Mm.
They are on the same team. We are not the only game in town.
Yeah. That's interesting.
Yeah. Yeah. So, for truly I say to you, whoever gives you a cup of water to drink because you belong to Christ will by no means lose his reward. This is basically those who treat Jesus' servants well are in fact treating Jesus well.
Mm-hmm.
So when you and I treat another believer well, we are treating Jesus well.
Hmm.
When we treat a missionary well, we are treating Jesus well. I think that is a great motivation to serve people. Because when we serve people, we are serving Jesus. We are treating them well and Jesus well.
Hmm.
And that's the Bible study.
That's good. It's humbling.
Yeah, hopefully.
It's humbling
yeah.
and convicting.
All right. Well, until next time, grace and peace.
For a groom, oh church, arise, he's coming soon.